time.
Wow.
Evening, welcome to the pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to the December 21st, 2015 Selectmen's Meeting. First, we have public comment. Anyone wishing public comment? Seeing none, announcements and community calendar. Mr. Waddell?
That's it.
Mr. Bridle?
I would just like to thank, I know the firefighters are over there tonight. They're sorting through the toys that have been donated.
Oh, good.
For the needy children. They are over there tonight getting them put away, getting them ready to give out to the families. And I'd just like to thank all the people in Hampton that have donated to toys for the Hampton Firefighters Toy Bank. It's a program that I hold dear to my heart. Having started it over 30 years ago, I'm very glad to see it still going on strong. I was told today they have over 50 families that they're helping out in Hampton, which will be for kids that may not have had any Christmas this year. So I want to thank all the people in Hampton for coming out, supporting the toy bank, and I hope everybody has a very Merry Christmas.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes, we received from the UNH Technology Center notices on our Public Works employees Rhodes Scholar Program. John Burke has achieved the status of Rhodes Scholar 1. It's the first achievement level of 6 levels in the Rhodes Scholar Program, and that's R-O-A-D-S Scholar. And let's see, Chuck Siemens has achieved the status of Master Rhodes Scholar and Safety Champion. And Christopher McGinnis has achieved the status of Rhodes Scholar 1 and Safety Champion. So congratulations to all 3 members of our fine Public Works Department for their hard work.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We're nearing the end of the year, and it's been a great year in Hampton. And for those of us and those of us that haven't been around the world and around this country, this is perhaps one of the finest, if not the finest, communities in the world with the greatest people, as citizens, as business owners, as taxpayers, as employees. And we'll be looking at the audit tonight, and that audit is tight. It has improved dramatically in the 4 years that I've been here. The economic performance of this town, the net position of this town, and as we look at the details of this audit, it is most impressive, and you would be hard-pressed to find a corporation in New Hampshire that is well-run, as well-run, as financially stable, and provides the level of service that this platform does. So the citizens of this town, the business owners, the taxpayers, and the employees have a wonderful, cohesive effort, and they're to be applauded. It is Christmas time. It is the holiday season. Whatever your faith, whatever your practice, happy holidays, Merry Christmas. We won't be meeting till very soon next year, and I wish everyone the best. I was in Concord today, Mr. Chairman, just to inform you for a matter of record, I did sign and had notarized by Karen Ladd at the Secretary of State's office a declaration of intent, special election for the state representative, Rockingham District 21. So I will be pursuing that office. And I can think of no greater accolade to pay or no greater example as you look at the folks that are first on appointments tonight is the Popes, what they've done for this town in terms of their stewardship of property, their improvement in property, their conduct of commerce. And they're to be applauded, and happy holidays to them. Back to you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Yeah. And I would like to wish everyone a happy holiday and a Merry Christmas. Our first appointment tonight is David Pope and I guess his wife.
Not consent. Doing the consent agenda?
Consent.
Oh. I'll be happy to move the consent agenda, the Hampton Cemetery the deed of the Scots.
I'll second it.
Okay.
All those in favor, unanimous. Thank you. Would your wife like to join you?
Moral support.
Yeah.
He drives the bus anyway.
Once in a while.
Well, that's why I invited you up. No. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Board Selectman. Nice to meet you all. And we're coming before you just to get your permit. We have all the other permits to get to revetment of the rocks in front of our house, which occasionally get hammered a little bit and move around, and we like to move them back. And so it's actually, this whole project's only going to take about a day. And it should not be a major thing. And I'd like, if possible, to get a long-term maintenance permit so we don't have to come and take your time and ours as well, just to maintain the thing. We don't do it very often. And as long as it stays put, we're in good shape. But moves around a little bit, we like to put them back. And so that's what our request is.
Thank you very much. Did you want to respond to that, Mr. Welch?
Well, Mr. Chairman, what I wanted to say was that they're all set.
Thank you.
What about the long-term maintenance?
Well, you don't have a policy with regards to that. You'd have to develop one along with conservation and the planning board because of the way the ordinances are written. But I would think that that would be something that could be worked on and eventually accomplished, yes.
Okay, well, we'll take a look at that, take that under advisement. Mr. Waddell.
No, I just think the packet that they put together was really well put together and well explained, and I read it, and I had no questions whatsoever.
Mr. Barlow?
Looks like they do a great job keeping the property up and helping us keep the water where it should be.
Yes. No, I think if all of them came through this complete, it would make it so much easier. So, thank you.
And Mrs. Wolsey.
I have no problem with it. But you wish the water would keep the rocks where they should be.
That's right.
And Mr.
And
Bean?
Is there a motion that needs to be framed?
Yes.
Do
you want to make it?
If Mr. Welch would.
Mr. Chairman, if the motion would be to approve the permit and conditions as written for this particular piece of property dated December 21, 2015, I think we're done.
So moved.
Second.
Yep.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you for
coming in.
Thank you.
How long does the permit go for under standard rules? 2 years?
I think it's 2 years, generally.
I think it's 2 years, but I'm not exactly sure.
No. Because you have an ordinance that requires you to end work by May 15th, 2016, so it runs to that date.
It says they'll do it in January.
Right.
Well, no problem. We won't be doing it this January. We didn't come before. This was all done last year.
Yeah.
And it didn't come before you last year because of the complications that were you were ongoing and involved and you rectified.
Yep.
And so that's why this is really a year old. So I won't be doing it until.
No problem. And you're all done.
Well, when do you think you'll be doing it?
We'll be doing it in April.
Okay. In April. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That should be fine.
Yeah, that should be perfect.
And we'll look at more at possibly seeing if there is some way that we can come up with a longer-term solution.
The state permit goes for a much longer period of time.
Yeah.
Okay.
And if it could coincide with that, it would be very nice.
We'll see what we can do.
Thank you very much.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays to all of you.
Okay.
Now, before we get to Scott Egan, I want to bring up about, it's come to our attention that one of the board members has submitted questions in advance for other people, including former selectmen and residents. And has everyone got this information?
No.
Got to them? Well.
I have, Mr. Chairman.
Mm-hmm. The problem is that submitting questions to the auditor from private citizens on the morning of the meeting where an auditor is expected to show and answer questions from the board is an abuse of the auditor's time and is an untimely imposition where the questions are detailed and require potentially much more study time before answering can be carved out during the day of the meeting. It has been 2 weeks since the board has had draft copies of the audit from Christie. So,
the attorney.
Another problem is if a single board member has questions about the audit, they should be submitted to me or the finance director and not to the auditors independently. This could lead to confusion on the part of the auditor as to whether one selectman is speaking for the board or just that the selectman himself or herself. And there may be a cost that comes from submitting these questions. A selectman should not unilaterally submitting, shouldn't be unilaterally submitting questions to our auditors that come from private citizens, whether those citizens were former selectmen or not. The proper channel would have been to obtain the permission of the board as a whole and let us decide what we, if we want to be doing that. So, Mr. Bean.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. It's a multi-eared formal lines of communication. You were uninformed about the information request. The rest of the board was. The finance director was uninformed. Town manager was uninformed. And until very early this morning, our auditors weren't informed for the request, and it's just not appropriate. Thank you.
Basically, these questions that have been submitted are not going to, we're going to come up with a protocol of dealing with these questions, but they're not going to be discussed this evening. Mr. Waddell.
I just saw this, so I have nothing to say on it. I'm going to digest it right now.
Mr. Bridle.
I've just seen it when you mentioned it. That's until Selectman Bean handed it to me, so.
And Mrs. Wolseley.
I submitted the questions in behalf of me, and they were kindly brought to my attention by constituents. And if people ask for information through their selectman, whoever that selectman might be, I think that's perfectly acceptable, and I expect at least a rough answer from Mr. Egan, whom I hope you will introduce shortly.
Other comments?
Yeah, and I would just say, again, that's a three-page email. I read those. I was in the office on other business this afternoon, and the finance director informed me of that. She was not informed of this information request. The town manager was not informed of this information request. There is the concern about the 15,000 other residents in town, if they all have information requests. Where does this process go, and what does that do for the billing for our auditors? There's no control, there's no leadership, and it will result in mayhem. You have just stated, Mr. Chairman, that you will develop a protocol to have this these interrogatories answered by the board, and I think that's fitting. I think it's appropriate, and it's only professional staff communication. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell. Mr. Bridle. So like I said, we won't be dealing with these questions tonight. We will decide a protocol, and we will deal with them later. Thank you. Did you have any other comments, Mrs. Wolseley?
Well, I have questions for Mr. Egan if you let him come up.
Yeah. Thank you. Next, we have Scott Egan from Closet Auditors. Please join us at the table.
Good evening. I wanted to start tonight with the review of the December 31st, 2014 financial report. I was going to run through the main points, the opinions, and some of the changes in the current year report. Through Christy, there are also a number of questions that she would like me to address and work through my review. So. Please, at the end of this, if there are any detailed questions or questions that you may have on this, if I've moved too quickly, please just let me know. But I want to make sure I hit all the points that Christy had conveyed to me that you wish to discuss this
evening. We appreciate it.
First, I wanted to start you on page one of the audit report, which is your audit opinion. And just to highlight a few items on there, just stating what we're auditing. Again, it's the financial statements of the governmental activities, each major fund, and the aggregate remaining fund information of the town of Hampton for the year ended December 31st, 2014, and the related notes, which collectively comprise the town's financial statements. Our audit was conducted in accordance with government auditing standards, and as opposed to prior years, this is actually the first year that the town has received an unmodified opinion on its financial statements since the implementation of GASB 34. There were two deficiencies that caused an adverse opinion for the governmental activities financial statements, which are your government-wide financial statements. Firstly, capital assets were omitted previously, and Christy and her staff have, they undertook the large process of accumulating the information to record all of the town's assets, including infrastructure, and that was implemented for this fiscal year. There are detailed notes that lay out the breakdown of the capital asset activity, but I wanted to address that firstly. Again, it was a large undertaking. I don't think, I want to say maybe 2 weeks ago, we came up with the final revisions and had all of the questions answered to be able to issue this report. So it certainly caused the delay in the issuance of the 2014 financial statements. With the bridge that is the GASB 34 capital asset implementation being crossed, I think that all parties will look forward to a quicker financial report next year. It was a large undertaking. Again, we're looking at historical infrastructure, and if you just take a look at when the town was supposed to implement, the town is considered a phase two government for GASB 34, which means that implementation was required in 2003. So beyond just the historical work, Christy and her staff had to actually go from 2003 forward, and there are a lot of stakeholders involved. Some of the things that I think delayed the issue were change in personnel at various departments who have knowledge of some of the assets, as well as working with the software vendor to make sure that the output of the reports was adequate for the needs of the financial statements. And those items all got ironed out in turn. And as a result of that, we were able to issue an unmodified opinion on the financial statements. The other statement, there was one other reason, again, for an adverse opinion, and that was related to non-compliance with GASB 45, and that is a standard related to other post-employment benefits. Essentially, for the town of Hampton, what that is a statement that required an actuarial calculation of the cost of maintaining retirees within your health care pool. It created something called an implicit rate subsidy, which needed to be calculated in a set of disclosures, which are found within this report, that again had to be contracted by a certified actuary to go ahead to get all the required documents and disclosures for this year's report. Both of those were obtained this year and allowed the unmodified opinion on these financial statements. In addition to the general financial statement audit, there was also a compliance audit or a single audit due to the receipt of more than $500,000 in due to the expenditure of more than $500,000 of federal funds during the year. Beginning on page 45, we also have opinions related to the single audit or the federal compliance portion of this. And what I want to draw your attention to is page 48, which is Schedule 1, which is a schedule of findings and question costs. It's a little easier to see what the town's opinion is here. As we just discussed, on the financial statements, the town received an unmodified opinion with no material weakness or significant deficiencies, and no material non-compliance related to the financial statement. So basically, there were no major, in addition to the numbers being fairly stated, there were no major control issues that gave me a concern as an auditor, say there's a potential misstatement within the financials. On the federal awards section, similarly, there were no material weaknesses or significant deficiencies identified, and the compliance opinion was unmodified as well, which again is a clean opinion, if you will. And this was based on the audit of the capitalization grants for clean water state revolving funds that were received during the year. And I won't spend a lot of time on the single audit other than to let you know that it was a favorable opinion, and there's a schedule of the federal funds on the following pages that you can review if you have any questions on that. And I apologize to start jumping around a little bit, but really the financial report for the town kind of starts in the back and builds forward. And what I want to start with is a summary of your general fund budgetary analysis, and this is basically what you're concerned with for budgetary purposes, for DRA, for tax rate setting. So it's most commonly what is used, I think, as a metric for budgeting. So I start there and then build up to some of the financial reporting questions.
Mr. Chair? Because
he has the floor. We're going to do it. He's going to make his presentation, and then you will have your chance to talk.
May I ask a question? I won't be able to remember by the time Mr. Egan is done all that we've gone through, and I have a couple of questions on what he has already mentioned. So may we have a chance for a couple?
Make notes. Please continue.
If you could please go to page 42. This is a summary of the changes in your unassigned fund balance for the general fund. And there are a couple of points I wanted to go over here. This is, again, a summary of your general fund operations for the year. This is a true budgetary accounting without any financial reporting combinations. The town began the year with basically $4.8 million in unassigned. Previously, you would have called that unreserved fund balance prior to GASB 54 of unassigned fund balance. Then there's a summary of the changes. The first one is the amount that was reduced of surplus used to reduce the tax rate from the prior year, which resulted in $1 million reduction in the fund balance. Then you have the results of the operations next, which is showing a revenue surplus of $371,000 and an unexpended balance or an under expenditure of your appropriations of $296,000.
What page again?
This is page 42.
Wrong page. Thank you. Gotcha.
The details of the operations, of the budgetary operations, can be found on page 39 through 41. And, you know, of note here, really looking at page 39, which are your budgeted versus actual revenues, the only major thing here you could see as far as a variance is related to property taxes, which was due to a large abatement, which in accordance with accounting standards is charged against the revenue during the year, which I'm sure everyone is aware of there. Other than that, the majority of the income was in line with expectations. There were some additional permit fees received in addition to what was expected with the budget, which is consistent with a lot of communities. Motor vehicle registrations have been favorable across the state in most of my audits, just as the economy has recovered a little bit. In addition, there were also some additional water pollution grants, which you received funding for this year. Basically, they're reimbursements towards debt service on some of the previous projects that you had undertaken, and those all kicked in this year prior to actually being included in the budget. So all of those things resulted in some of the favorable revenue variances. If you look at page 40, there really isn't, things are pretty much in line again with the budget. In the front of the audit, there's a management's discussion and analysis, which Christy has prepared, you know, which indicates that basically, you know, within about 1.5% of budget is where you landed. You know, there are some things typically that, you know, might have been budgeted in an area charged to another, that there's no, you know, a savings in one area rather that, you know, you use to spend out of another without a formal budget transfer. So it's common to have minor variances, but there's not much of note in relation to the total budget on these pages. But again, that's where you would get that detailed information of the department level expenditures and results. The next section, as far as the components of the changes in fund balance, is a little bit more technical. You have to account for the changes in other restrictions to fund balance, and there are different levels of restrictions based upon the type of imposition, whether it's an external restriction or it's something that management has designated or it's something that was voted at town meeting. They all have various levels of restriction in accordance with GASB 54. And this is a summary below of an increase in non-spendable fund balance, which is generally an increase in most commonly prepaid items or inventory.
Scott, what page is this?
This is on page 42. My apologies.
42.
Up at the top on 42.
A decrease in committed fund balance of $28,000. That again is related to typically to items voted at town meeting, a change in prior year. Let's say there was $200,000 and then $228,000. That would account for the change there. And the decrease in assigned fund balance for abatement contingency. As I mentioned, there was a large abatement passed through are charged against revenue during the year, resulting in the recalculation of that contingency, which is a balance sheet item at year end, and that abatement contingency, you know, in review with legal and the assessing department, was significantly decreased. That's where it shows on the financial statements. What this brings you down to is an unassigned fund balance of $5,457,505. This is the fund balance that you actually report to DRA, mm-hmm. and that they're concerned with for tax rate setting purposes when they try and evaluate what potential fund balance is available to be used with your ensuing warrant articles that you're working on. So for 2014, the number is $5,457,000. Below this, there's a reconciliation to some of the other financial statements here. These are budgetary financial statements, but you're also required to present two other types of financial statements, governmental fund financial statements, or general GAAP basis financial statements, and government-wide financial statements. So this reconciliation shows the differences between your budgetary fund balance and your financial reporting GAAP fund balance. The main difference is there is a more restrictive view of what can be called revenue in your governmental fund or GAAP basis financial statements, which could be found on page, let me go here, starting on page 10. This presentation is slightly different. It breaks out the general fund, but the general fund also includes blended trust funds and some other items that are different than budgetary purposes. It also presents the town's other major fund, the permanent fund, and all other funds as one consolidated unit, an aggregate amount. The difference here is due to something called a 60-day rule, which under the basis of accounting for this financial statement, you're only allowed to record revenue that was received within 60 days of fiscal year end. There was a change that we have presented as a restatement to the governmental fund balance related to this after consultation with GASB. Previously, this number, and one of the questions was that this number in prior years had been much higher as far as the difference in revenue between the two statements. One thing that we had always viewed as a firm, if you take a look at tax collection in New Hampshire, we're kind of unique, and it doesn't exactly fit the GASB model. They're more based on a county collection system, more commonly than how taxes are collected here by the local towns, and then typically they have different fiscal years than their school, and they're holding money cross period for the school. So what had been done in previous years and was common practice in the state was to consider the entire amount of the uncollected tax balance and only count what was received, defer everything that wasn't received within 60 days of year end. But if you take a look at the financial statements on page 10, there is a large liability, an intergovernmental payable of $13 million. And in the notes, there's the exact amounts, but the majority of that money are balances due to the Hampton and Winneconnet school districts due to the timing difference in your fiscal year ends. The taxes that were collected on this warrant that is outstanding and still receivable, partially receivable, those revenues, $13 million is pledged to the district. However, due to their cash requirements in their fiscal year end, they have a predetermined payment schedule and you haven't paid that out yet. So what we have done is only considered in consultation with GASB, and we wanted to get their guidance from their technical team on this, was we felt that deferring the entire amount related to this was unfairly decreasing the net position of the general fund because this amount is included in the liability. So we have only included the proportionate amount that relates to the town, and that is based upon the town's percentage of the overall tax commitment. Because again, we felt it unfairly penalized New Hampshire communities in this situation where you have a calendar year end town and a fiscal year school that is already carrying an intergovernmental payable to essentially, it would be double dipping that revenue recognition. So that was one of the things I know that Christie wanted me to cover. That is a change here, and again, based upon the discussion, we presented that as a restatement to fund balance. We recalculated the beginning fund balance, and going forward, that will be the methodology for calculation that's been agreed upon, you know, between Christie and myself as far as how that's looked at. And then finally, there's a small, again, without getting too technical on you, there's also other adjustments also related to the 60-day rule. You don't recognize an allowance for uncollectible taxes on these statements because you already have that 60-day cutoff, so anything that's in an allowance would de facto be not collected in the 60 days already. And that comes down to your fund balance, your unassigned fund balance of $4,641,181. And that is what flows to page 10 in your governmental fund financial statements. Page 10 through 13 are your governmental fund financial statements and reconciliations to the reconciliations to the government-wide statements, which we'll get to in a minute. And again, the majority of the assets are in cash at year end. You also have the large property tax receivable, which we have discussed, and the main payable amount being the school district payable of it's a little over $13 million. I think there's $1,000 or so due to the state in that as well. Taking a look at your other fund balances, again, you have non-spendable fund balance of $136,000, again, related to prepaid items and tax-deeded property inventory that's being held. Restricted fund balance of $177,000. Committed fund balance of $2.5 million. That is mostly related to trust funds, expendable trust funds that are included in the general fund now for reporting purposes, and an unassigned fund balance, which is mainly budgetary encumbrances of $816,000. And again, we come back down to that $4.6 million that we discussed. The permanent fund, again, mainly that's your real estate trust fund, and that balance is included in the second column. Your other governmental funds, those are all other funds of the district that have not been blended into the general fund, and those funds, they're individual or combining fund financial statements that, let's see what page they begin on here. That begin on page 42, I believe. No, it's not 42. 43. And that shows you, again, if you're looking for the other information, you're only required, this is not a required schedule, you're required to report it in one column, but this is just an additional breakdown that we provide for, just for transparency and general disclosure. It helps people track things over time, and we found it useful to include. Lastly, I wanted to just highlight on the financial statement, and I just wanted to highlight the governmental activities, and this is the accumulation of everything that you've seen on page 10 and page 12, as well as additions of capital assets and long-term liabilities, mainly the debt that is associated with your capital assets. So you see approximately $50 million of assets related to the net book value of capital assets that was brought on during the year. And again, you've already been recording the outstanding debt and their debt schedules and amortization schedules in the back of the audit. You've already been recording that, but what it's done is it's increased your net position and basically shown a net investment in capital assets now of $26 million. Prior to that, you didn't have that offset of the asset against the debt, and you were in a much different financial position. You can see that, again, this is as restated if you look at page 9. So if you were to look at the 13 report, you get the true difference of bringing this on. But we calculated the beginning balances of all of these to show the change during the year, rather than saying, you know, you increased your net position $50 million, it's shown as just the change that occurred in 2014. There were a couple of other items that Christy asked that I speak about that we've been in discussion about that I wanted to bring up, and they both apply to future GASB pronouncements that are coming down the pike. The first one is GASB 68, and that is essentially the recording of the town of Hampton's percentage of the New Hampshire retirement system's net pension liability on the financial statements of the town. GASB 68 is effective for this fiscal year, for the December 31st, 2015 fiscal year, and it requires the recording of a large liability and other related items. It's actually a very technical standard, and other related items to this pension liability on the financial statements next year. And again, it is timely that you have implemented capital assets, because that will severely impact your net position next year going forward. It's a new financial, it hasn't changed the funding for your pensions, but it's a new financial reporting requirement that says of the total amount that's unfunded, in actual, let me be careful how I phrase it, the total essentially actuarial amount that they've determined is unfunded for the retirement system has been broken out based upon your proportionate contribution to the system and has now been allocated down to everyone's balance sheets. So that will be coming on board next year, and without the addition of these capital assets, this balance sheet or statement of net position rather would be in a much weaker position to someone from the outside taking a look at that and wasn't aware of the substantial infrastructure and capital assets that Hampton has. Again, this is something that mainly is going to be, we've already implemented this for our June 30th, 2015 audits, and mainly it's a coordination of work between New Hampshire Retirement System and their auditors, KPMG, as well as us. And from the town's perspective, we have to do some additional census testing and testing of some of the information that is sent to New Hampshire Retirement System. But there are, the retirement system has actually done a new actuarial evaluation, had that audit, had certain schedules that are required for the statement audited. So it relieves a lot of the burden and actually allows us to issue, you know, hopefully another, again, related to this, an unmodified opinion related to that. The problem with this standard was so much of this information that we're relying on for you is held by the plan. And really the plan being New Hampshire Retirement has taken upon itself to follow AICPA best practices and issue the appropriate reports, including opinions from auditors on the schedules that we need to include in your report, so that I don't anticipate that being any type of issue with the 2015 audit based upon my experience in this last round of audits of my June 30th, 2015 clients. That's something I certainly want you to be aware of, because I think it's going to be, as more reports come out and people talk about this, it has been, typically, it's been a point of interest and a point of confusion with a lot of people. But I do want my boards to be aware that this is coming down the road. It is applicable to you. You know, myself and Christy are aware of it, and it'll be included into the next set of financial statements. And so if you do have any questions on that, to please let me know. But if someone is talking about that to you, a net pension liability of the New Hampshire retirement system, yes, that does apply to you. Another important thing to note on that too is this is a financial reporting requirement. It is not, it does not address the funding. And I don't have the rate off the top of my head, but if you look at the current rates for New Hampshire retirement, and firefighters are 27 something, 29. So in that current funding amount is a built-in component to pay this net pension liability down over the long term, which is something, again, that they're, the retirement system is working on and they're required to do. I think that's a lot of the reason behind what GASB says, and then there's the actual effect of this statement is that people are taking pension funding a lot more seriously. And again, so I just like people to be generally aware of that. And if you do have questions, let me know. But yes, it applies to you. Yes, the New Hampshire Retirement System has a funding plan to pay this liability down. That's why the current rates are so high. That's not just paying a current benefit amount. And finally, the other item that Christy wanted me to discuss was GASB 67, which was basically disclosure requirements for tax abatements. And the statement is going to be effective for your December 31st, 2016 audit. Like anything, if possible, they always say earlier implementation is encouraged. I don't have any clients that are early implementing this at this point. The main thrust behind this statement is related to, I guess I would say, a mutually beneficial tax abatement where, as an economic development tool, you know, an example that I have in one of my communities is an outlet where there's favorable tax treatment for the outlet based upon the jobs and the general economic development that is brought forward. There was no discrete disclosure of that in audits before, and now by tax program, or a tax incentive program, there is going to be a disclosure requirement. And previously there was none. They went back and forth. It's kind of a midway because there are certain things contractually and whatnot that can't be disclosed about individual taxpayers. But really this statement is meant to give the users of the financial statement, allow them to quantify these types of agreements and how integral they might be to the financing and to the revenue raising of their particular community. A component of this is also going to be how to handle additional, you know, individual type tax abatements, and that is going to be determined. There's flexibility on that to be determined a lot by town policy. So that'll be something that I'll be letting Christy know as some best practices and typical things become available. You know, I'll be making her aware of areas that she can research to help advise the board on what some general practices are for adopting that statement. But again, I know that was a general question. That one's a year off, but as things become available, it is one that as a board you're going to want to have to have some general knowledge of and some guidance, I think, as to how to put together that you know, that individual component of the policy that isn't as cut and dry as some of the bigger tax incentive program disclosure requirements. With that being said, I think I hit everything that Christy and I wanted to talk about, but I wanted to open it up to any questions that you may have.
Did you want to add something at this point, Christy?
Nope, I'm good.
No. And Phil, did you want to start?
Yeah, please, and thank you. And I would just like to point out that this is the director's first round, and what a quantum leap towards a more excellent audit and compliance with GASB.
Yeah, and let me, I thank you for bringing that up because I did want to touch on that as well. You know, generally when there's a changeover at the finance director position, the audit can be a little choppy the next year as they try and learn the new position, but it really was seamless with Christy. And not only do you see the effects here in the unmodified opinions and the work on the GASB statements, but you know, from a general standpoint, there were no additional journal entries or unusual adjustments or things. The records were in the same, you know, in the same general good condition that they had been. And sometimes with a change in guard, sometimes that lapses. But I did want to let you as the board know that Christy and her staff both did all did a great job.
She continues to bat 1,000.
Thank you, Scott. I'm just going to go quick. This is some quick questions. If you can give them layman's terms and bullets right back. On page 4, you talk about an excess of liabilities over it's a $55 million corporation. Is that what you're saying in that position?
Let's see. This is from Christie's MD&A.
Page 4.
Yeah, and let me just back that up to what I look at, which is my number.
55 million and change?
Yeah, and that should be the net position.
If you could explain that in layman's terms to the where this is televised.
Net position, I would say, if you could think of this as a personal financial statement, this would be your net worth if you were an individual, but extrapolated out to a town.
Thank you very much. So it's an incredibly valuable corporation. The net position from 2013 to 2014 increased by almost $3 million.
That is correct. Yep.
Quick comment on that. Is that good or bad?
No, that is good. Any time that you see an overall approval or improvement in the net position, that's a good thing.
Wonderful. The GASB, we start out at a tour on page 7, totals at historical cost. 2014 is $105 million. We have depreciated $55 million. We're on page 7 on your graph. Could you explain that? That increased by $2.35 million. Is that an expense, if you could explain that in layman's terms?
Sure. Let me take a look again. Sorry, I'm not as familiar with the management portion here, but let me look at that. Page 7.
2013 to 14 goes up $2.35 million. Accumulated depreciation. Could you explain the significance of that as an expense?
Sure. When an asset is capitalized, to move it over as an asset, there was an actual expenditure during the year or in the preceding fiscal years.
Right.
And to consider an asset, it's removed from the expenditure. And instead of being charged to one financial period, the expense is charged over the useful life of the asset. So that is the total amount of accumulated prior assets that are being depreciated. That is their 1/20th if it was a 20-year asset, or 1/10th of the amount. Basically, it's trying to match the expense to the benefit that is received in the financial period. So that's just a difference in how the accounting goes between the accrual and other statements.
Thank you, Scott. And for again, for the layman, is there can you extrapolate that towards in terms of a capital improvement plan or acquisition? A program, is that an expense, a degradation of assets that will at
yes.
some point have to be? So this really is a $2.35 million expense?
Yes,
would,
it is a, yes, generically it's a $2.3 million expense on the accrual statements. Some expenses get removed to capitalize them, but this is the offsetting expenditure.
Thank you. So that's about a 10% friction on our budget, a little less every year, or at least this last year. Could you comment on the success that the finance director and the financial staff did in the long-term debt with that transition and a gain of $438,000?
Yeah, there was a debt refunding during the year. And again, just simply by refinancing and taking advantage of the change in interest rates, again, the economic gain, which is generally disclosed, is the savings of present value savings of $438,000 over the life of that debt service, as opposed to not doing anything. If you just stayed and paid the course without dealing with that, that's the today dollars savings over the term of those bonds.
Wonderful. Thank you. In my opening remarks tonight, I talked about what a wonderful corporation, what a great town this is. This is on page 18. The town of Hampton is a municipal corporation, governed by an elected 5-member board of selectmen and Mr. Welch, the town manager. And of course, our bosses are the citizens of Hampton. And again, it's a $55 million corporation with almost $30 million in expenditures on the municipal side. And I'm pretty impressed by that. Trust funds, good to go on that. Is it very unusual for a town to have as much money as we do in the trust funds?
The real estate trust is unique. I would say your expendable and capital reserve funds are typical, but again, that's one of the unique aspects of the real estate portfolio, which is now in the trust fund, is a unique component. And you know, certainly most communities don't have that type of operating offset with the revenue that is typically generated from there.
Thank you. On page 21, you've got a graph at the bottom. The municipal portion of our tax rate is 7.24.
Correct.
For $20 million and change. The state of New Hampshire is 2.52, roughly a third of that, with a total of $6.747 million and change going out the door. Where's that money go?
The 6.7?
Yeah, the $6.7 million.
Yep, that is the state school assessment that gets reapportioned back to the communities.
Okay.
And if you were to take a look at the, it's not within the audit here, but as part of the tax rate setting process, part of that gets reallocated back to the town in the forms of payments towards Hampton School District and Winneconnet School District's assessments in the form of state aid.
Okay, and so that $6.7 million does not go to the benefit. Hampton taxpayers pay it, but we receive no benefit from that, is that correct?
Well, I guess the way I would say, the benefit is received through the independent school districts.
Okay.
So while you are the agent to collect all of those funds, the town of Hampton only, you know, receives $7.24. The rest goes out, you know, the county portion just goes out to the county.
Mm-hmm.
The school portions, that goes back and is redirected to Winneconnet and Hampton School Districts.
Okay, and I'm sure it's...
And they have a separately voted budget that comes into those numbers.
Okay, and I'm sure we're not getting back $6.74 million, but that is one-third of the municipal side of the house just to go to that state fund, and that's significant. Page 22, 1N, claims and judgments, again, talking about the outstanding caliber of this corporation. The last sentence, there were no significant claims or judgments at year-end. Please comment.
Yeah, each year, again, a unique thing with the in-house counsel, we get a detailed legal letter from Attorney Gerald summarizing, you know, any potential suits or issues. And if anything rises to the level where it potentially needed to be disclosed or needs to be a contingency, we account for it. And based upon that review at year end of ongoing matters that, you know, there's nothing additional to add.
Thank you. Page 29. Compensated absences,
mm-hmm.
On the graph up top, that incurred additional red in excess of $112,000. For the town right now, it is very close to $1.3 million. Mr. Welch has a remedy for some of that in partiality. Please comment.
Sure. As far as a compensated absence liability is concerned, I would say, again, there are various mechanisms that towns can use to fund that. Some use an expendable trust where they actually set aside assets. More commonly, and not that this is better, this is probably the more common thing that I see, is that they put time frames for notification of leave in for retirements to try and at least provide a warning so that you can budget annually the amount that is being spent out on these leaves. There's always things that you cannot predict and unforeseen retirements, but typically that's a fiscal measure that the towns employ so they can be notified and then budget and appropriate the funds. Certainly compensated absence trusts, the trust funding would provide a little bit more flexibility in that, again, it number one would help you increase the net position by funding the liability and having an offset on the asset side of the ledger, and also again gives you flexibility, you know, beyond even some of the general timeline restraints, that if for whatever reason there were a lot of people that left in any given year, you'd be able to take the money from the trust fund and not have it impact the current period. Mainly what we're concerned with when we look at this is, does this liability into the historical trends create you know, in interperiod inequity where you're having to forego things in the current period to pay for this liability that was on the books. I haven't seen that, but certainly it's always good to discuss the, you know, fiscal management options for dealing with that.
Thank you. I see it as a salient. It is growing. It's growing by 10%. It's 5% of our budget, give or take, and I think the board's prepared to address it going forward. Page 34, GASB 45.
Mm-hmm.
Could you compare and contrast and comment and how that relates, if at all, or differently from GASB 68 that you said is looming very soon?
Sure. GASB, real black and white, GASB 45 deals with health benefits and other types of programs other than retirement, and GASB 68 deals with retirement. Due to the nature of how everything works, the retirement piece is almost exclusively, I have clients with other retirement system, but it's almost exclusively the New Hampshire retirement system net pension liability.
Great, thank you. Just one last question and comment. Director, fantastic job, fantastic audit. Scott, could you share a little bit about your background, your credentials, and share with our viewing audience a little bit about your firm?
Sure. I, again, work for Plodzik & Sanderson. We're accounting firm out of Concord. our municipal division performs over 135 municipal audits annually. I've been with the firm for about 8 years, and prior to that, I was in private accounting and in private corporation prior to that. And again, we're unique in that normally most accounting firms do a little bit of municipal work and a lot of tax work. We're about two-thirds municipal, and we do have a traditional tax and accounting practice, but this is our focus. I've been in the lead on this audit for several years back when Mike was on board as well. And typically, supervise anywhere between, typically around 30 municipal audits a year.
Wonderful, thank you. We have great confidence in you, Director. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Wardell.
Just quickly, number one, I'm going to reiterate what's already been said about Christie. That, I mean, 2003 GASB 38, is that the
34?
34 should have been implemented, right?
Correct.
And it wasn't.
And it was partially implemented. The capital asset portion was not brought on, but there were other elements of the
system. So now 2014, this audit.
Yes.
So, I mean, that was a very large job to do.
Yes.
And it was very, very well done.
Yes. It was an extremely large undertaking, and I'm sure Christie's glad to be done with my question.
Yeah.
I think because there were, I had quite a few just to make sure that, again, bringing on $50 million and...
Yeah, I just want to reiterate that and reiterate to the public that this should have been done in the past. It was not done in the past. It was done now, and it was done very well in 1 year.
Yes, and again, it's a big undertaking to implement the capital assets, but when you add on the fact that this should have been done in 2003, it just makes the job all that more difficult when you have to go back and provide the supporting documentation and whatnot for these records.
Right. And that's one reason that the audit was so long in getting out.
Yes.
There were people saying, where's the audit? Where's the audit? Where's the audit? And there was a reason the audit was late.
Yes.
It wasn't that somebody was not doing their job. There was a reason.
No, correct. There was a lot of back and forth because as we implemented and the software got straightened out and the reports came, you know, I had numerous questions. We performed observations. Some of the items we had to recalculate and go back, make sure that the periods were reasonable. So there was a fair amount of work on my end that also got pushed back on the Christie just to satisfy the audit opinion on the capital assets. But I think, again, we went final on the report about 2 weeks after the last bit of information. That was all that was holding it up to that point.
Thank you. And 68, that's going to have to be done, you said?
68, yes. That'll be implemented in your December 31st.
And that'll show up as a liability for us, right?
Correct.
Whereas the actual liability is in state pension, right?
That is a big argument. Yes.
And it's a huge argument.
It's a proportionate share. I understand where you're going. There's some confusion in that because you currently don't have a mechanism to pay that down.
Right.
It's paid down through rates. It's a multiple employer cost-sharing plan. So if the town of Hampton wanted to pay $1 million, $1 million doesn't come off the town of Hampton's liability.
Right.
Only the small percentage of the liability would get credited to you, and you know the state of New Hampshire would take $500,000 of that off their liability.
I just want people to be aware of that. So when that starts showing up as a liability, it's not Hampton's fault. It's not.
No, and I think that's part of having the discussion here. It's not directly controlled by Hampton in that you are required to make the financial reporting change to record the liability and the other items related to it and disclose that. However, I guess the true adjustment to that is going to go through the ongoing contributions that are being used to pay down that liability.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The other thing is Selectman Bean brought it up, and I agree 100%, the compensated leave fund. It would just seem like a trust would be to have the money there would seem like a much smarter financial mm-hmm. decision, would you say? I mean, there are other ways of doing it to fund it.
There are other ways, but certainly as an auditor, I feel that gives you the most flexibility if you are able to appropriate that money. Again, the concern really comes down to do you have a period where you're not able to appropriate that money, and is that going to take away from services that you were looking to provide in other areas in any given fiscal year. That hasn't happened yet, but it's less likely that that would occur when you have a funded or a partially funded trust fund to help offset that, so that in the case that that happens, you've got, you know, a rainy day fund to help avoid the impact of current services.
Right. And I have one more question. Hopefully you can answer it. Can you give a definition or make people understand what the unassigned fund is?
Unassigned fund balance, it would be the surplus, I would say, the surplus of the town. You have assets in the form of cash and receivables. You have true liabilities, you know, accounts payable and things like that. Then you have other restrictions on your reserves. Some of them are statutory, where you're not allowed to spend money in the case of, say, a real estate trust fund. You know, the principal is remaining intact there. You have other commitments on money that it's pledged maybe for an expenditure in a future period, or as a budgetary encumbrance, or other restrictions on that money where it hasn't been spent yet. It doesn't meet the definition of a liability, but there's a future claim on that money. The unassigned fund balance is what's left. It's the surplus, if you will.
But it's not necessarily a cash.
It is not a
savings account.
It is not a savings account. No, the cash as an asset is your cash commonly. You know, in some communities, Hampton has a fairly healthy cash balance. In some communities, a lot of your unassigned fund balance can be in the form of receivables, non-cash. So, you know, people want, sometimes in smaller towns, will say, well, where's that money? Well, it's in your property tax receivable. It's not necessarily in the bank. So, yes, there's a distinction there. That's not cash. Cash is cash, but this is the net difference of assets minus liabilities, less other restrictions or claims on the funds of the town.
Right. And some people keep looking for a simple answer to a complex problem.
Yeah, and it's
nice if they did some investigation and learned what it's about. So that's it. That. And I'm going to end, and I just want to say thank you to Christy again. I mean, it's a super huge job, and I want people to realize that. Thank you, too, Scott.
Mr. Bridle?
Yeah, you talked a number of times about the report being unmodified this time. Mm-hmm. And can you explain a little bit about what unmodified and modified funds, just so that,
sure,
I mean, the layman can know what it is, yeah, and what the difference is, and how we've been in the past, where now we're unmodified, but I guess.
Sure. Unmodified, or in slang, is a clean opinion, basically saying that these financial statements, all the schedules and notes within, are fairly stated in all material respects. Previously, you had a modification to your opinion on the governmental activities. So what it meant, if we use this report as an example, would be that the financial statements were fairly stated prior to this, the general budgetary and fund information. However, I could not say that your government-wide financial statements, Exhibit A and Exhibit B on page 8 and 9, were fairly stated, because the capital asset figures were omitted, the long-term liability related to the other post-employments were omitted, as were the related required disclosures for those items. So previously, again, the other numbers, the baseline numbers, were okay. However, these statements, we could not give a clean opinion because they weren't fairly stated. They were missing material information, and now that information has been provided, and we've audited that, and similar to the previous opinions, that, again, it's an unmodified opinion saying that now these statements are now fairly stated, and you've also complied with the required disclosure requirements that are associated with those.
And getting back to what, and because we have that, is simply because of all the work done by our finance department.
Correct. Yeah, it's the only way to do it. Again, we made comment, you know, in the audit each year, obviously, but again, until you just went through the process of inventorying everything and then getting it into a spreadsheet and getting it into a financial software that could depreciate it and come up with all the required disclosures that you need, that was the only way to remedy the issue with the opinion.
Thank you, Christy.
Mrs. Wolseley.
as a member of the Budget Committee 10, 12, whatever years ago, I can remember Budget Committee members asking why GASB 34 was not being implemented. And a lot of the answers that we got were that it's just something the auditors think up so they can do a little more work. It's nice to see this coming to fruition. What effect did it have on the, perhaps on the credit of the town when we carried the adverse opinion on the audit all those years?
I can't speak to specific credit implications, but in general, it really, I think, depends who you're dealing with and their knowledge of your financial statements. Mm-hmm. Certainly, not just the clean opinion, but from any metric and any ratio that a credit analyst is going to use, you need assets to offset the liabilities. Mm-hmm. I think, again, there probably would have been understanding that there are some assets there, but certainly it wouldn't help you to not have them recorded. I can't say, specifically in a particular bond issue, did that factor into the cost or not? It really depends where you went for that and what type of system you're using. But certainly, with a brief knowledge of some of the scoring models and whatnot, they look at things in terms of certain liabilities for governmental entities, certain liabilities as a percentage of assets and as a percentage of revenues when they're, developing their scoring to figure credit worthiness.
So if your accountants tell you you ought to implement some measure, you probably ought to pay attention.
Yeah, and well, this is a big one.
Now, I think I asked the manager last week, Fred has given us lists during the year of property the town owns. Is there a site that we can go for or a master list that shows us exactly what properties are stipulated as part of GASB 34? Is something online, or how do you preserve that information? Is that...
Well, Christie maintains a capital asset listing, which is an inventory of all the assets.
Uh-huh.
And that's something that, I evaluate and retain with my work papers for the audit
right. For
the required period of time. But the district maintains all those records and, adds to them on an ongoing basis as things are purchased.
So is this something that one of us or a member of the public could say, may we look at it? Is it something that's...
Sure, yeah. It's something that Christie has available. So
probably not going to have a stampede, but you would have, okay. So we can assume that will be maintained every year. Now on your page, okay, the capital assets at year end for 2014 showing on page 7. The assets, total net capital assets are down a little from the 2013 position. What happens in 10 years or 20 years or whatever when the assets keep depreciating? Do we end up by having nothing as a town? How low can you go?
Typically no, because generally your assets are being replaced. The useful lives are designed to actually cover the period useful life of the asset. So if you get down to zero on something, it generally means that it's no longer usable and you'd have an asset to replace that. So, an example would be the fire stations that you just replaced, that eventually those will go down to zero. But if those go down to zero, they're probably not functional for you anymore. And you'll be looking at either a major improvement or something of that nature.
Certainly took long enough to get those done. Okay.
100 years amongst friends.
Oh, good grief. Let's see. Covered some of the... On page 14... And this is the thing that really gets me going. Bottom, under other financing sources and uses, net change in fund balances, and you've got the non-spendable fund balance, the decrease in committed fund balance, the decrease in assigned fund balance for abatement contingency, unassigned fund balance beginning and unassigned fund balance ending. I get the abatement part. Of course, the terms keep being changed, which I think annoys me and confuses everybody, because I still call it surplus, to be perfectly frank with you. The strong suggestion from revenue admin is that towns hold from 5-odd% up to some odd 17% for a contingency in case of a big judgment or a big problem. Where does that fit in? I know it has nothing to do with abatements. Where does that fit in here? Is that, that's the unassigned fund balance?
Correct. That's what they're talking about, is the unassigned fund balance, which at year end for 14 was the $5.4 million. So it would certainly be within or on the high end of that range.
Okay, so that theoretically would be recalculated every year.
Correct.
What makes me concerned is we have, I think we have a list of about several Warren articles here to the tune of $444,500 that will be proposed in March for normal, basically what would be normal operating budget expenditures. I'm concerned about drawing down the unassigned fund balance for that type of expenditure. How should we be trying to maintain a level or a base, say 5%, 5 to 7% each year?
Well, I mean, I think, I mean, firstly, I would say developing a realistic budget is the start of it, to know what you're getting into going forward. It's an ongoing battle that boards struggle with. Again, I think you're within the recommended amount.
Okay.
But it's unique. It depends on the community. It depends on your particular circumstances. It depends on the amount that you have in reserve and trusts, and your ability to, you know, expend, say, money as agents for some unforeseen issues.
Mm-hmm.
So it's unique anywhere. I think that's something that, you know, boards always struggle with, is stability in the tax rate and maintaining a healthy fund balance. And again, I think the trend over the last several years in Hampton has been that it has been building, even with the use of some of these fund balances. And also to note, I mean, there are still contingency amounts in there. They're just lesser than in previous years. So I think part of it is to identify those estimates, really, and record them so that, you know, they're not part of that fund balance and you're not being caught by surprise or having to use an unforeseen amount of that in any given year.
It's been my understanding that if one is to take money out of the unassigned fund balance, it's a smarter thing to do to assign that the monies to the capital reserve or capital reserve funds rather than operating budget expenses.
I mean, if you look at, when you say smarter, that again is just shifting.
Right.
It's really shifting it over from an unassigned fund balance to a technically a committed fund balance that now.
Right.
It was just part of your surplus. Now it's designated for a specific trust purpose.
Right.
To be used as an amount going
forward.
Vis-a-vis
operating budget. Pulling out for operating budget.
Right, and then generally, again, it's just planned, and then, you know, you are able to take money from the unexpended balance of those trust funds to supplement and stabilize the tax rate in the future.
Right. Another comment I get from the public is that why do we bother figuring out the capital assets? What do we care? You know, what could happen? Well, what could happen?
It's not a very sophisticated perspective.
I'm assuming that a large judgment against the town or something, would that factor into the capital assets?
You mean as far, I'm not sure I understand the question.
I'm an accountant, Phil.
What?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Well, you have, you're showing a value of approximately $50 million in capital assets. Are we declaring that, is one of the reasons we're declaring that, in case something catastrophic should happen and the town should be sued by somebody, we would have assets to supplement? What's it for?
It's to present the financial position of the town fairly, is what I would say. And the easiest way I could explain it is, it would be misleading to say, if you look at page 8, and you have 23 million, let's call it 25 million in long-term liabilities due within a year and due within more than 1 year, that you, as a town, contractually entered into long-term debt agreements for $25 million that had no economic benefit to the town. I think, like with anything, you got to match the other side of that, and it would be misleading. Certainly, it's misleading to say that the town of Hampton doesn't have any capital assets of value, quite the opposite. So that's why I would say, I don't think it has any, you know, effect on judgments or anything like that. It's more just a fair presentation. This is a snapshot of what you owe and what you own at year end, and it gives a fairer picture of that.
So we don't have to worry about selling the town office?
Correct.
I could grab it.
Just for a second here, because I have a couple of other things flagged. The trustees section, it appears that there were no deficiencies or no problems or whatever with the reporting on the trust funds, including the real estate trust fund.
Correct.
Okay, that looked good. And one second. Okay, I think that is it for the moment. Thank you so much for coming. This is a big help, I think.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I'm set.
Fred, do you have questions?
And just finally, a reason we heard on Gatsby 34 was it would be too expensive. Director, you did that in-house, and it was minimally invasive. And again, more reason for kudos, because that was my tenure here for the last 3 years, too expensive. You nailed it. Mr. Welch nailed it. Thank you.
Mr. Welch, any comments?
No, sir. Great job.
Thank you very much for coming in tonight. And thank you both. And thanks, Christy, for helping us out. You did a great job. And
Scott,
we're glad to hear from you too, Scott, that she's working so hard for the town of Hampton. Thank you.
Thanks for giving clear layman answers.
You're welcome.
And the November.
I'm next, I think, so
yes.
I figured I'd just stay here.
Yeah, you're next.
I'm next.
You're up.
First, I have to thank the department heads and their staffs and my staff in the finance, too, because they helped with GASB 34. I didn't do it all alone. I had a lot of research done and got a lot. It's good that we have some longtime service employees here who had some of the history, since we did have to go back so far. And Fred and Christina with the roads and assessing and public works, all the departments were very helpful. And we're probably almost as glad as I was when that was over. Probably not as glad, but almost as glad. So kudos to all of them. And I have, it was my first year, but we have to realize Kathleen is the only one that's still in the finance department who had been there, and she was in a new position. And then I had two new employees also who were learning. So I just wanted to point that out and thank all of them. I'm here for November for the finance, and I'll be quick, a lot faster. Yes. Okay. I have to talk slowly.
No, you can talk fast tonight. That's
I can?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. I'll try and
you guys all heard that, right? It's the 11th report. The target was 91.67%. The month's total income without capital reserve was $592,000. Motor vehicles came in at $276,000, which was $37,000 over the month's target. Other major contributors to the month were payment in lieu of taxes at $120,000, that's the NextEra settlement that was done last year. interest on taxes at 8,000, building permits at 18,000, departmental income at 40,000, franchise fees at 66,000, and the real estate trust at 46,000. The expenses for the month of November, the target was 91.67. The departmental totals without debt service was at 88.29%, which equates to 3.38% under the target, or $789,000. So we have shrunk that gap. I think it was 37 or 57,000 a couple months ago.
37.
When I was 37 when I was sitting here. So we have put tight constraints on the department heads, and they have really curved their spending. So overall, the departments as a whole are under the target. Since I appear to be sounding like a broken record each month, I'm not going to point out all of the supplies and expense lines: electric, heating, fuel, gasoline, diesel, staff development, OT wages, and maintenance lines like I've been doing in the departments, because they're all still over, mostly as a result of having the default budget. I'll just point out to you guys some of the other items in the departments that are over, or any departments that are over as a whole. I also would like to note that the career incentives and holiday pay lines have now been expended. Those are contractual through the collective bargaining agreements, and they are paid out the last payroll in November usually, because they had to be paid by the first of December. So we always have paid those out the Thanksgiving week. So a lot of times people will ask during the course of the year, how come those lines aren't being expended? It's because they're one-time types of expenditures. And they now, if you look at them, you will see they are all either very close to target, maybe a little over, a little under. So that being said, I'll just quickly go through the different areas. Town manager section as a whole is at 92.77. They're a little over target. Under the finance department on page 2, the postage line is at 108.33%. Just remind everyone that it's not just finance postage, it's postage for the whole town. Assessing contracted services is still over target. It's at 106.37, that section as a whole, assessing. MIS, the four equipment related accounts when combined, are $8,000 under the budget. Planning board, the advertising is now over budget by $2,000. In cemeteries, part-time wages and contracted services are both over target. The police department, when you include the open POs, is at 88.4%. There is a list there of a few accounts that are over. Most of them, nothing new there. It's all the same ones that have been over throughout the course of the year. Fire department is at 88.84 with open purchase orders. They have vacation wages, firework detail wages, rentals and leases, and the fire stations and building as a whole now is over target at 107.76%. Highways and streets is still over. They've been over since, I think, February of last year with all the snow, which we don't want to talk about anymore. Municipal sanitation is below target at 83.58%. The only thing that is of note there is the transfer station as a whole is over target at 102.76%. Culture and recreation, the account to note there is under administration. The uniform expense line is over. The warrant articles, since I've actually done this report, we are down to, that's encumbrances. Sorry, I got excited. Warrant articles are being expended. A lot of those projects are complete. Under the 2014 encumbrances, it was at 89% when I did the report, but now I'm down to just one purchase order left open, which Fred and I are hoping to pin down the DPW director and figure out if he's going to use that or not. So the 2014 encumbrances, hopefully within the week or so, will be gone completely. So the recreation, when we're looking at the special revenue funds, the recreation fund, the beach sticker donations year to date is at $16,709, with $21,000 being awarded in scholarships. Cable committee is now, the check for the school has been cut for the $36,523 for their Channel 13. Private detail is below the 2014 balance by $21,000. The EMS fund, the balance is growing, and it is now just over $500,000. And under the wastewater system development charges, we have collected $196,000. $82,000 of that is earmarked for projects that the board has approved. And so that would bring the balance down to $114,000. That was fast. Any questions?
Questions, Mr. Bartle?
Nope. Excellent budget as always.
High Street Culvert.
Yes.
Non-lapsing.
Yes.
Article 23 that's being proposed for 2016. Says that the we are going to amend the non-lapsing Article 16 that was passed at the 2014 annual town meeting for the purpose of replacing the outfall culvert located below the Gristmill Dam on High Street to raise and appropriate an additional $147,500 for that purpose. It says in here, in the note from the manager, that $235,000 has already been raised from taxes to complete this project. Why has that been raised from taxes if nothing has been spent and we did nothing on that culvert?
You appropriated the funds.
We appropriated the funds.
The rest of it was in a grant formation.
Right.
Okay, but the funds were appropriated.
But when we appropriate the funds, even though no work is done,
they're still appropriated, so they're still there. They can't be transferred
but
to another purpose.
But if this never gets done, it would eventually elapse to surplus.
It would.
Is
that is correct.
What you're saying?
Okay. That is correct.
And my other point on the warrant articles.
You might say that the reason I put that article in was to settle the problem. Either we're going to do the work or we're not. If we're not, then that money needs to escheat to surplus.
Right, and I appreciate that. And then I had asked... I talked to Fred and asked him at the request of the public to put under old business on tonight's agenda the Gristmill Pond Dam, and I see that the $650,000 that was appropriated on the 2015 warrant obviously has not been spent.
Correct.
At some point in time, perhaps under old business, we can just ask for an update on the RFQ or...
That should be going out either this week or next.
Okay, because the...
That's the RFQ for engineering.
Right, because the neighborhood is becoming concerned about not having any forward movement on that. Okay, Christy, thank you very much.
Mr. Bean.
I have nothing for the director, sir. Thank you. Thank you, director.
Mr. Waddell.
Nothing. It would be the same questions as every month because it's the same thing, but it's going good. But I just want to point out again that the increased revenue from the fire department permits, which is really good. The increased revenue from motor vehicles, which is good.
Parking.
Yeah, I'm getting to that. Parking tickets, which is good for us, not good for somebody else. And the parking revenue is really good. So, I mean, those are all good revenue sources.
Building
too, yes. I'm sorry, I missed that.
It goes to building.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's going well. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your report.
And I did a quick year in production for you guys.
Thank you.
$722,000.
That's good.
And I also have.
Do you ever sleep?
Yes. Sometimes.
We're printing money again.
Thank you.
Yes, I think as long as you're here, Mr. Chairman, we've done a lot of work. Christy's done a lot of work, and so have the departments on gasoline and diesel. And we'd like to present a proposal to you to decrease the gasoline and diesel sums, and I'll let Christy go through that because she's worked up these wonderful spreadsheets and totals.
And there's some color on them.
Oh, yes.
This is good.
For Christmas, sorry. I told them this morning I needed to be sprinkled with Christmas cheer.
And she did in color.
Yeah.
It helps.
I haven't been sprinkled with Christmas cheer yet, but I'm sure it's coming.
That's great.
Basically and we have to give Jamie Sullivan here, has been working on this with some of my staff. And we have implemented actually last week. It's called WEX, W-E-X. It's a credit card type of an account that they issue cards for. And in the past, when we tried to use like local gas stations, the taxes were an issue because the town had to go through all of this paperwork in order to get that money refunded. Well, with this program, the WEX does it all for us. So they literally are only going to be billing us what the cost is minus the taxes. And with the pump prices being so low and the state price still being at the, I think it was 267 last time we,
yep,
on the October bill, I think it was 267 a gallon, which is a lot higher than what you're paying at the pump. So you can see,
absolutely,
that this is a better way for us to go. So basically what Fred and I did after Jamie implemented this program is we went in and adjust every gasoline and diesel line in the budget. Mm-hmm. This is gasoline and diesel for vehicles only,
yep,
not for,
yep,
the diesel that they use for their special like generators and some of the equipment at Public Works. That's a different contract that we have with Atlantic Fuels. You can't get that at the gas pump. Or the boats at fire, we didn't adjust those lines. But every other gasoline and diesel line was adjusted. And instead of using the $3 a gallon that the departments were using, Fred and I had already adjusted it down to $2.35. We've now adjusted all the gasoline down accounts down to $1.95.
Wow.
And all of the diesel accounts down to $2.06. So it was, it ends up bringing the administrative column of the budget down by $112,638. So, which would be a savings that we would like to, I believe that we will need a vote from you guys so that we can put this new budget, so to speak, forward to the budget committee with these adjusted gasoline and diesel lines in it.
Questions, Mr. Waddell?
No,
yeah, we do
good.
Need a motion.
Yes, sir.
Did I hit all that right, Fred? I mean, is,
yes,
there?
Yes, okay. You need to amend, request the budget committee to amend the budget submitted by the selectmen for their consideration.
I make the motion to request that they amend the budget.
I'll second.
Please.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Other questions? Mr. Bridle?
None.
Mrs. Woolsey?
No, thank you.
Just a kudos to the assistant town manager and Christy and Fred in driving this. They responded to the comments from budget and the realities of the marketplace, and they did a nice job and they saved us a lot of money. Thank you.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Yeah, I have one question. On the estimated year-end savings, Christy, dated 12/21, you have $722,235,
mm-hmm,
and Fred, you froze expenditures.
More or less, yes.
Now, is it possible before the year end or using that?
You're going to get it down the budget in a few minutes.
Oh, okay.
The question's coming. It's a good question.
Okay.
It's going to be there.
See if we can forego some of these.
Thank you very much for coming
in
tonight. You've been most helpful.
Yep. Good.
I think that we're going to go out of line, if it's okay with everyone, and move on to the our discussion on old business. Mrs. Woolsey brought up about wanting to know some more information. And I noticed that in our audience tonight, we have, do we have a speaker for the grist mill out there?
Andy,
no, I think Mr. Hurley and Jim. Jim has volunteered a lot of his expertise, and we're very lucky to have two men like this. And
yeah. May I make a quick observation?
Yes.
While the gentleman is sitting down? One thing that Candy mentioned to me that hadn't occurred to me, but she said that I guess the feeling is that there may be a hesitation on the part of some contractors when it comes to the process of rebuilding a dam, because this, for a contractor, is a relatively small dam, just like sometimes we have problems getting people to bid,
yeah,
on the high street drainage,
right,
because it's a, quote, small project, not to us, but to the contractors.
Right.
Have we considered that?
We have. We've looked at some of the dam projects going on, both in New Hampshire and Massachusetts, principally in Massachusetts.
DAM projects.
They're very small projects, and there doesn't seem to be a lack of bidders for them.
Oh, okay.
So until we see something to the contrary, we're going to continue to proceed,
okay,
to try to get this done.
I think a lot of people recognize that Norm here has been doing a lot of, he's been sort of,
yeah,
being the leader here. People may not recognize Jim Metcalf.
as well, and I'm hoping that Jim will give us a little bit, let us know about your expertise, what you have to offer here.
Sure.
Been so generous with your commitment.
I'm a retired engineer. I spent more than 40 years working on power stations. I'm not a civil engineer, but I'm a mechanical engineer. I'm licensed in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, where I practiced. So I may not know a lot about the structures or the hydrology, but I know a lot about moving water, and that's the expertise that I volunteered and what I bring to the table.
Thank you very much. Would you like to start, Mr. Welch? Or?
Well, Mr. Chairman, we've finished with the dam at Ice Pond, and that was a number of reasons we held up doing this project is simply because we wanted to see how good the engineering data was, and it wasn't very good.
Yeah.
Neither were the estimates for the work. We then sort of sat down and had independent review. We talked to some folks on the information that was obtained for the original turnaround for decommissioning the dam. And there was a healthy concern on the part of our engineers in-house with the fact that there's a lot of data that isn't there and needs to be there in order to do this and do this as most efficiently and effectively as we can. We made the decision about a month and a half ago, 2 months ago, affirmatively that we were going to go out and select new engineers or request
yes.
engineering proposals. We're concerned that the data is not present, and because of that, an effort to try to use the data from the original data bank would be fraught with problems, and in fact, we wouldn't get a good bid. And if we did get a bid, it wouldn't be a good work project. We want this to be the best work project there is, but we also want it to be the cheapest work product that we can get for the best work we can get. So I believe Public Works at this moment is ready either tomorrow or Monday to send out the proposal for the engineers. We have a list of a two-page list of engineers who are from the state who would be willing to bid on this type of project, or not bid, but send a proposal for engineering work. We want to have that done sometime in the first 2 weeks of January. We want to proceed immediately so we can start getting this thing going. Spend this money, get this done, and as soon as we can during the calendar year 2016, get the work started. That, in a nutshell, is a synopsis.
So where do we go from here?
I think, the obvious is we're going to send out an RFQ within the week to select an engineering firm, and we'll have several meetings regarding that when we open those. These gentlemen will be invited so they can sit down, listen to what's going on, and give us their opinion as well, because they're literally part of the team. And then we need to go and redo everything that was done for the decommissioning, because we're reversing the process, and it's not just a straight reversal. There's a lot of information that needs to be obtained. It needs to be obtained very quickly and very effectively, and we're going to be have our two engineers in-house watching this very closely. I certainly, the engineering firm we select is going to be, feel as if they're under a microscope getting this work done, because it needs to be that way. We need to aggressively work at this.
Yeah.
We need to aggressively be next to them working at it. And we need to very aggressively state things that need to be done and take a yes for an answer every time. Unless there's something we're not aware of.
Did you gentlemen want to ask any questions or contribute?
No, other than we have been in touch slightly with Fred and
Chris
Jacobs.
Yep.
They had informed us that they were going to go back to sending out a RFQ more widespread so they could get a better grip on this. We are aware of that. I think we're on board with that. I don't see issue. Didn't know the time frames. We were, it's nice to hear that the time frames are moving on.
Right.
We knew there were some issues with the ice pond, and there were other things that had to be done during the summer months, such as the road from 101 up.
Oh, yeah.
Right. So
we're kind of on board with what's going on. We just, you know, we heard that there were maybe some questions, so we were happy to be show up and be here and wish everybody a Merry Christmas.
Mr. Waddell?
I'm fine.
Mr. Bridle?
No, I'm fine. I'm glad that Fred's brought us up to speed on it, and look forward to getting it done.
Yeah. Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, I hate to see warrant articles passed and then sit there. And I am, especially after the ice pond experience, I really want to have a firm figure. I don't want somebody to come in and say, we'll do it, and then eat.
Right.
Yeah. So I think we're on the right track.
I hope so. Obviously, as we were going through this process with ice pond, there were a lot of delays. We were concerned with that process. It turned out that their bids were very low, but the bid prices coming in were very high. We don't want to go through that process again, so we want to know exactly what we're doing and why we're doing it, and we want to get in there and get the job done.
Mr. Bean.
Get her done. Thank you.
Yeah. And Merry Christmas to you gentlemen as well.
Thank you.
We appreciate that you came in tonight, and I guess this is your cheering gallery back there.
It's a good gallery.
Thank you very much.
She's a lady who knows how to pick up the phone.
Thank you.
We're going to move back to the approval of minutes.
Also move that we adopt the minutes of December 7th, 2015.
Second.
All those in favor?
Pearl Harbor Day.
Thank you. It's unanimous. And the town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman,
one moment.
Members of the board, town offices and facilities for citizens, and you should be aware we're going to be closed on Friday, December 25th, so the employees can celebrate Christmas with their families. There will be no selectmen's meeting next Monday, December 28th, because the board had previously voted not to hold that session. Warrant articles for town meeting must be filed by 5 p.m. January 12th, 2016 in the selectman's office. Property owners who wish to file for elderly, blind, veterans, or any other type of exemption allowed by state law or for current use must do so by March 1st, 2016. Please inquire of the assessing department, as state forms are required to be completed in many cases. We want to make sure those are in and done in time. Residents of the Hampton Beach precinct who wish to avail themselves of the alternate property tax rate should contact the assessing department to obtain and complete the necessary forms that are required for that purpose. Town offices will be closed January 1st. If you have a vehicle registration that needs to be completed before the end of the month, please do not wait until the final day. Those lines tend to be a little long, and you don't want to be standing outdoors waiting. Everyone, please enjoy a safe and very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. I have a number of other things, Mr. Vice Chairman.
Okay.
that need to be addressed.
Go ahead.
For those who are interested, and there may be a few, I want to just tell you that there will be a special election to fill the state representative seat for the town of Hampton. That begins Tuesday, January 19th. It'll begin at 7 o'clock in the a.m. and be closed at 8 o'clock in the p.m. for the voting. We're not sure, but that may be a primary. If that is a primary, and the number of people required to in fact have a primary on that date run, that will be the primary date, and the election date would then be March 8th, which is the annual town meeting date. It'll be coterminous if we need to have a primary. If we do not have a primary, then January 19th, 2018 will in fact be the election day.
Wow.
So, persons who are interested in declarations of candidacy may file with the town clerk on December 21 and 22 of this year. That's, yes, today and tomorrow, during normal business hours. You may file with the Secretary of State from December 21 through December 24th and Monday, December 28th, 2015, if you are interested in being a candidate. So those are the relevant dates as we know them currently. We've done the review of the Mill Pond Dam, so I'm not going to belabor you with that. We have a a draft warrant article, which we've given to all of you, to correct an error that goes back some, well, some decades, to the 1960s. There was a, and this one has a little plan attached to it. I think you all received it.
Very interesting.
Okay. There's a portion, actually two portions, of this old roadway that need to be abandoned. One is 1,676 square feet, and the other is 1,758 square feet. The owner of the parcel above wishes to purchase the parcel below. But in order to originally combine these lots together, it would be impossible for the person to redo the lot below because they would then have no frontage without this road being only partially incompleted. So we're looking to discontinue that to help them out in order so they can in fact do what they want with their properties and reestablish these buildings and do it the right way. These properties are going to be, because they're going to continue to be separate properties, the upper portion of the discontinuance will go with the upper property, and the lower portion of the discontinuance would go with the lower property by state statute. We're doing it this way so the lower portion of property actually has frontage. Because without doing this, by discontinuing that whole road, that lower property will have no frontage whatsoever, and that will pose a problem for the property owner. So that's for the board to review later on. It's a non-money article, and we'll get there eventually. I'm have great news for the board. The state of New Hampshire, through the Department of Safety and Homeland Security, has awarded the town a $100,000 grant for the new generator at the wastewater treatment facility that's projected to be in the bond. So that $500,000 generator can now be reverted to a $400,000 generator because the state has given us the money to do that.
I hope you put that in capital letters and something. It's a unique experience.
Going to put it in more than capital letters. I think we might actually get a barrage balloon and float it over the town. We had we had a request from the TA, from the Safe Roads to School program to, in fact, do some improvements, off-site improvements for the academy. We understand that would be in the budget for the academy renovation, and it would provide some quieting of the traffic coming out of Academy Avenue by two small islands at the end, so people couldn't park right up the edge of the roadway.
Plans and stuff. Yeah, I believe, you have them upstairs.
Yeah, I believe these got handed out at some point in time in the process. But we'll get there again. I just wanted to call it to the board's attention. The school would be required to come to the board because this is public property and it belongs to, under the control of the selectmen, to approve these little bump outs.
Yeah.
So they won't be parking right up to the edge of pavement on Academy Avenue.
Yeah.
That's the purpose. This would be funded by the school. There'd be no cost to the general taxpayer of the town. And this is part of the roads, the Safe Routes to School program. We had two warrant articles submitted by the school dealing with the renovations of the academy building.
Well, one to the town and
well,
one
comes
to the
town,
one
goes to the school, right.
Yeah.
There are two parcels of property known as the Arnold property and the Martell property that sit between the, well, what was the old courthouse and the frontage of the school that's owned by the town. The Arnold property is property that is used for bus parking and bus depositing children at the school at the academy. And the Martell property is used for parking. And in order to complete the school project, they would like the town to consider reverting those two pieces of property to the school district as school property. Right now, they're the users of it, and that's by a town meeting vote. So that would have to go on the warrant if the selectmen approve.
I have a question
now
on that.
Okay, well, let's wait till it's your turn to ask questions.
Okay. That one.
That's what we get for letting you sit in your office all week.
Compensated leave trust fund. Christy has indicated that there is going to be a generous portion of funds left over. And we're going to propose to you two individual things that we think should be done. It's up to the board to do that.
Okay.
One of them has to be done tonight. The other one can be done at a later time. If there are funds left in the employee separation cost subline account and the bank buyback program subline account, and there usually is every year, in the past, the board has authorized those funds to be transferred to the compensated leave trust fund, which is the $1.4 million that was discussed tonight for, yep, for debt that the town has and is not funded. As opposed to, this would, if you did that, this would allow us to either continue or withdraw the article that was approved in the warrant.
Okay.
So you need to consider that. We do need to do something before the end of the fiscal year. So tonight would be a good night to make a decision on that. We also have a request, and I think this was in your warrant article separately, from the Recreation Department, and that deals with the purchase of a Scarfire that was in there,
yep,
their original proposal for the town meeting. Mm-hmm. We've done a lot of work on this, mm-hmm, and the cost of that is $21,292. And that includes the interim increase in cost from the manufacturer to the supplier, mm-hmm, who put the acceptable bid in. And we would ask the board to approve that $21,000 sum so that we could, in fact, go ahead on the bid,
mm-hmm,
to go ahead and purchase this piece of equipment. There were only two bids, and that's why I'm bringing it to the board. So we'd appreciate it if you would approve that this evening. I've also given the board, and you received this today, I believe, because I went through the 300 and some odd pages of the 10-year highway program, and I pulled out for you every one of the items dealing with Hampton or a town around Hampton,
yeah,
that may affect us as far as highway work is concerned. That also includes the work that's necessary for the Taylor River Dam, which we're watching quite closely. And I did notice in the proposal that was put forward by State DOT that it has either replacement or removal. So they haven't made their mind up yet, but we all know because of the removal, the past process of removal, there was 722,000 cubic yards of,
yep,
contaminated waste behind the dam face that we need to be very careful of because that can have dire effects in the harbor. So I've distributed this to all of you, and we're going to keep an eye on what goes on in that entire process. We received a communication today from Eversource, which is, of course, the electric utility that supplies high-tension wires. They run through town, and for the next several weeks, they are going to, between 7:30 a.m. and 5 p.m., they're going to be having helicopter crews hover low over these wires,
mm-hmm,
inspecting them in the various towns where they have the wires, which is about 20. So if you get scared out of your wits by someone coming too close to the wires with a helicopter, it's being deliberately done. The police know about it. Fire department knows about it. This has been approved by the State Division of Public Utilities.
Where is that at?
Those are up in the western side of town.
Yep.
There's a high-tension series of lines that come through up off of Timber Swamp Road, and there's a substation up there. It's very important that we let people know so that they're not scared to death when all of a sudden a helicopter comes swooping in over there, over their property. So, yeah, you never know.
They did that in Seabrook last year.
Yes, and they're doing it again now in several other towns, so we're one of them. The Health Trust has notified us today officially in writing that the Cadillac tax in the Obama health care bill has been delayed for 2 years until, mm-hmm, 2020,
yep,
and the president has signed the bill, so that's done. Good. We did receive today, and we'll be having a meeting with Primex next week, a proposal for them to provide property and liability insurance or workers' compensation insurance to the town. There is, as far as we can determine, something in the area of a $100,000 increase in the cost of insurance, and it's fairly important that we analyze that and find out whether or not it's compatible with our current coverage. So we will be meeting with them next week to try to determine that. And then last but not least, thank goodness, we have a, the chairman of the precinct approached me last week and indicated that they're concerned over the new rates for fire inspection that was approved by the board for the fireworks for the precinct, and they don't have the money in their budget. My suggestion would be, excuse me, that since we do this cooperatively with them, you might consider abating those costs, except only for the precinct, because they're another governmental unit, and everybody else would have to pay their fair share of costs to the fire department for fire services and supervision of all fireworks displays. I leave that to you for your discussion.
And are you suggesting that the following year it would be
We'd amend the ordinance?
Yes.
But you could do it administratively at this point, and that would solve their problem and make relations much easier.
My recollection, though, was that they said they couldn't meet that payment in their current budget, but in the future,
yeah, and
would be agreeable to coming under it. I would entertain it as a temporary.
Yeah.
Okay. Questions for the town manager's report, but not to do with the warrant articles, because we're going to talk about them next.
Separately, yeah.
Mr. Breidel.
You want to, you had the scarifier. You want to make a have a motion for that?
Yes, if I
yeah,
could.
Yeah, that's sensible.
That's a motion on the rec department for the 21,000.
Mm-hmm. 292.
292. I'll make
second.
That motion.
Yeah.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Unanimous. No-brainer.
Solve that one.
You had another one.
The other one was for the compensated leave trust fund.
You want to see
if there is sufficient funds remaining at the end of the year to transfer those funds over.
I'll make that motion too.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Nothing else at this time.
Mrs. Woolsey.
In the minutes of our last meeting, or the December 7th minutes, I mentioned something about the ramp at Place Cove, and Fred, you said something about not being able to get permission from the state. There's an Americans with Disabilities Act. What planet is the state on?
Not this one. We've made that argument.
If we
there doesn't seem to be a tremendous willingness on their part. What's going to happen?
You're being dignified now, a tremendous willingness, yeah.
Well, yeah, I'm trying to be polite, yeah. Because I have some other feelings about this. They have they just don't want to go there right now, and I don't know why. It seemed to me that we could, in fact, put in a set of wooden steps going down there that could be removed during peak winter time when we get a lot of storms.
Wheelchairs aren't going to go down wooden steps.
Well, and there's just no way to get them down there without building some sort of a ramp.
Yeah, because people can walk down a ramp.
Right, right.
But
no,
you can't do a wheelchair downstairs.
I understand that. Yeah. There's just no way right now to do that. Part of the problem is the ledge that's slightly offshore. that's really junk ledge. There's rocks about this big that keep on coughing up from the ocean, and they flood that whole area with rocks. So we'd be down there after every high tide with shovels clearing them off. That's a problem, and we really need to find a way around it. And perhaps the way around it, and one of the things we had thought of, is to, at the far end of the upper parking lot, which was to build out an access ramp and have one of those elevators that can go up and down to bring people down to the beach in wheelchairs. That's not cheap.
I know.
It's expensive. But it would be something that's really permanent and would be protected.
Because
so.
It seems sad that people can't access the beach.
We get a lot of complaints about that. We've tried a number of occasions to do something about it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want us building anything down there. I mean, I suppose I can, if the selectmen want me to, I'll just go down and build it, and they find us. What I don't want to do is build it and then order them to tear it out.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for looking into that.
I'm going to continue because it needs to be solved.
Any other questions?
Appreciate it. Nope.
Mr. Bean.
Negative.
Mr. Waddell. Thank you for your report. Moving on to the discussion about the warrant articles. Did you want to lead us, Mr. Welch?
I'm not sure about the leading part, Mr. Chairman, but we have a number of warrant articles that are in the mix. And I'll just quickly brief them down. Police facility video security system, the purchase of police tasers, the SCBA filling station at the fire department, the fire radio system upgrade, replaced fire command vehicles, the drill yard fire training, the fire turnout gear, replace fire telephone system, and replace fire ice rescue system. The cost of those is $444,500. I know Christie gave you some figures earlier in the evening. It appears that at this point in time, we're going to have about $720,000, excuse me, left in the budget at the end of the year, somewhere in that general area. Mm-hmm. The proposal here is to earmark $444,500 from the current budget to purchase this equipment with the selectman's permission, and to withdraw all of these articles from the warrant. There would be our best guess at the moment, mm-hmm, is that there would be about $500,000 placed in surplus at the end of the year, okay, even with these purchases.
Okay. So why don't we approach that? We'll start with that.
Okay. So do we need a motion for this to?
Well, let's discuss it. Do you have anything to discuss about this?
I think it's a great idea. I think it clears up the warrant articles. I think it's a great idea.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes. First of all, the fire ice rescue system, I didn't think we approved that. I don't remember approving it. It's just maybe my.
I think you did. I think you did.
Okay. But my problem here is, I think this is a cleaner way to do it than to try to tap the unassigned.
Mm-hmm.
And the fire requests here are desperate. And the police video.
They're past desperate.
Is desperate. So this is stuff that I would rather not leave to chance,
mm-hmm,
on the warrant.
That was our general feeling,
this
too.
This and the self-contained breathing apparatus station. We've got to get these things.
Well, sort of the police department's the same problem. The video security system, that's,
mm-hmm,
that's a huge liability to,
yes,
us if we don't fix it.
Oh, yes.
The tasers, to me, that's a very economical way to do things simply because they're not life-threatening weapons.
I was going to recommend, if we had this as a warrant article, that we would put replace police tasers.
Oh, yeah. The ones we have are
we
not
won't
even salvageable.
We have to consider that. I agree with what you're saying here and get it over with and meeting the immediate serious needs of these departments.
Mr. Bean.
Pending, hopefully, very little discussion going forward. So moved.
I'd like to discuss this in detail.
Yes.
No.
Good for you.
No, I think it's a really good idea to do it this way and get it out of the way. And we've gone through every one of these, and they're a necessity for the departments, a real necessity. But I want people to know that this leftover money is not leftover because of poor budget, you know, because we overinflated the budget. It's leftover because we put a stop on spending money, right?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. In order to make sure we had money at the end.
Yeah. We had a $300,000+ deficit in the Public Works Department because of the huge snow problems we had in the spring. We had to make that money up, so what we did is we shut down everything except for essential expenditures, just bare-bones expenditures. That's resulted in some good management in the Public Works Department and other departments. And it looks like right now we've got $740,000+ left in the budget that appears not to be being spent.
I think it's a good idea. And I think, you know, waiting until we see that the final results of what we have for money and waiting, and, you know, there was much ado about nothing all around on warrant articles and stuff that people hadn't seen yet.
Yeah,
just wanted to make that statement.
I guess the other thing I need to point out is that if I'm going to encumber these funds so that we can proceed, I need to sign the purchase orders before December 31st.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So do we want to make a motion?
Phil
made the motion. A second.
Yeah.
All those in favor, unanimous.
I have a small pile of warrant articles, which has just become smaller. So, what would you like to do with them?
So, Rusty, did you want to ask any questions about the other warrant articles?
No, I've gone through this list before, so I've got no problem.
Mrs. Wolseley.
The collective bargaining obviously isn't set yet.
We believe that will be.
Right, we will be pulling the articles that Fred and we just voted on.
Yes, ma'am.
I just have to say that I think it's really silly to discontinue E Street, but that's all right. If your majority of the board wants it on there.
Let me, because I think we're going to have to explain this. What we did was we went back to the creation of the Hampton Beach Company, the improvement company,
right.
And we read the deed, which transferred the current property where the casino is,
yep.
And they transferred from the corner of D Street to the corner of E Street, and all the lots contained within that circle, and then they skipped across D Street and went from E Street to F Street, so E Street's still there.
I know, but I can't see anybody.
And it's still town property.
Plowing through the casino.
Well, no, but my point is, if it's there and it's still town property, yeah. This will clear up a defect in title,
okay.
And it's a simple motion
it's just
to make.
Like kind of
it's a pain in the neck thing.
But, yeah, but the rest of it, I don't have any problem.
Mr. Bean.
No questions, sir.
Mr. Waddell.
Oh, we've been through all these. We've discussed them. We've discussed them with the department heads.
Any other information you need, Mr. Welch?
No, sir. That should do it for me.
Okay.
Looks like we're down to about 30.
And may I say to the manager.
37 or 38.
That the inquiry from whoever they are, Verizon, to the building inspector was one of the neatest emails I've ever seen. God bless Kevin Schultz. How often would some of us would have liked to respond in that manner? He hit the nail right on the head.
He did rather put the thing to bed, yes.
Any other further questions about the town manager's report?
Nope.
One thing I just wanted to say, only because I happened to stop in and see Kevin today, currently there are over $41 million worth of permits out for new construction.
Yeah.
And he's on a, he expects to probably break his all-time record.
That's what he said to me that day, too.
And it's, I think the permit fees are like almost, they're going to be over $300,000.
Yeah.
So it's amazing that, you know, we're lucky to have employees like Kevin.
His basically his department plus almost another half a department is what he's funded.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But there's a downside to all that.
Wow.
Because more public services required, more traffic, wear and tear on the roads, et cetera. So somewhat of a bonus, but not much.
Moving on to the status report on trustees of the trust funds. Do you want to start with that?
Yield.
Sure. Last week, the board voted
4-1.
4-1 to issue a letter to the trustees of the trust funds, reminding them of the obligations they have that were imposed by the Attorney General's office in an earlier letter, November 20th, and also to remind them of inquiries that would be helpful to elucidate whether or not Mackinson and Company has ties to Warren Mackinson, which are factors that some of the trustees, when they met with this board, indicated would be relevant to their decision making as to whether to continue with Mackinson and Company. Since this letter, I have received some inquiries from Chairman Silberdick asking me various mechanical questions, one of which was about whether a meeting could be conducted with only a portion of the trustees there in person and others there by a means that would allow interaction with the public. And that is possible by RSA, the right to know law. No meeting has yet been scheduled. A couple of dates were thrown out, and verification was made as to whether personnel would be available to broadcast those as the selectmen have requested. We've yet to see a meeting scheduled, however. There are some, also an inquiry was made to me about who would have expertise in the area of securities law that the trustees could hire if they chose by way of outside counsel. And I have provided them some names, having done a little inquiry of that, including the Attorney General's office. Couple of undercurrents that the board needs to be aware of. There seems to be still some thought that the trustees are being driven by a member of this board to do what the Attorney General's office has told them they need to do. Another is whether or not they need to have Mr. Mays there at one of their meetings so that he can be personally questioned publicly about those items that they have said are relevant to them in their decision making. Mr. Mays has sent a letter to the trustees. I've shared that with the selectmen. And frankly, I don't believe that they're, all the questions they need to ask have been answered. So that's just the status of where this stands.
Questions? Mr. Bridle.
Well, I have a couple of thoughts on this. First, the issue before the trustees, I believe, is being confused by Mr. Silberdick. This is not an issue of Mr. Bean pushing around the trustees. It is a public confidence vote. The public has a right to be concerned about the SEC agreement as it relates to the Mackinson and Company. The Board of Selectmen have voted 4-1 to express their concern that we believe that the trustees may not be taking this situation seriously enough. I believe it must be properly explored to be in the public's interest is protected. At this point, it appears it is not being done. I highly recommend that the trustees fully explore the situation, inform the public of what is being done, so they may be confident that the trust funds are safe and being properly invested.
Mrs. Wolseley. Mr. Bean.
I endorse what Mr. Bridle says. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell.
Yeah, you know, it's not a scientific poll or anything, but I've made sure that anytime I'm in an event lately and everything, I ask people their opinion on this, and I've asked a lot of people from, you know, all town residents, all town taxpayers, in the banking industry, business owners. I went down and spoke with one ex-state elected official who's a business owner, very well respected, and every single solitary person I have talked with has said this should be looked at more in more detail than it has been. It has not been transparent, and a lot of them just voiced that Mackinson should be dropped. Now, that's not maybe for us to say, but I mean, I have not had one of these people say to me, oh, it looks fine, it looks good. Everybody, and a lot of people, and a lot of very important people, and people that know what they're talking about.
I will confirm also that this is a popular topic of conversation, and a lot of people have asked me, and I haven't, you know, people seem to be somewhat appalled, you know, whether they understand it fully. It's, you know, hard to say.
Well, you know, one person I spoke with has been involved with this for years and years and years, and was part of the legislation to putting the legislation in to have people borrow from it at one time. So I think he knew a little bit about what he was talking about.
Mm-hmm. I just want to make sure, though, if there are other attorneys hired, they do have to come to the Board of Selectmen to get permission, correct?
That's correct, if they wish to have the town pay for that attorney. Because mm-hmm. this board is in charge of the legal department budget for outside counsel, The trustees themselves have no independent line for that, and that's correct.
Any other questions? Mr. Welch?
No, sir.
Okay, any old business? Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mr. Bridle?
Nope.
Mrs. Woolsey?
The landfill monitoring, oh, we're going to go on to the landfill monitoring services. Okay, and I do want to handle that school articles request with Mark here especially.
Okay, good.
Is that all right?
That's perfectly okay.
Because my, and I did receive your email, thank you. The proposal is to submit an article for the town warrant and the Hampton School District warrant predicated upon the study, and I gave you guys a copy, the chairman has it right there, conducted by the school district on the rehab of the academy. And I would say that I certainly agree with submitting these articles with one caveat that I would like to see inserted, that we are willing to give up the property, but I think the original draft said something about for a dollar purchase the two properties.
Well, the original warrant article that allowed them to use it was at the rate of $1 per year.
Right, but I thought when they had initially drafted this that they had a purchase price of a dollar on there. Yeah. But I would stipulate in here very clearly that this is only going to take effect if the bond article for rehabbing the academy passes. Right. I don't want to be giving away town land, just giving it away. So if we include that stipulation, then I would be certainly in favor of going ahead.
I was going to ask for the same stipulation, just simply because if status quo remains, it remains.
Great minds on the same track. There
How
you
about
go.
The great mind part on my side?
But I was concerned about that. So, Counselor, there you go.
Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
No comment, sir.
Fine.
Yeah. Moving on to new business. The bid for 2015 to 029 landfill monitoring services.
It's been a long night.
Purchasing already. Policy waiver section 718-4, period B2.
Mr. Chairman, we've gone out to bid as we do once every 2 years. Because we are required to provide landfill monitoring services as dictated by the Department of Environmental Services for our landfill. And there's a great deal of monitoring that goes on during the course of the year. And reports have to be, engineering and technical reports have to be filed. There were two bidders. The low bidder was $7,900, which is the company that we're suggesting should, in fact, be accepted. And the high bidder was $11,750. That's per year for 2 years. And we would request that the board approve the low bidder as a waiver from the purchasing policy.
So moved.
Second.
I have a question.
Ma'am.
Please.
Are these the individuals, is this the individual firm that is doing the groundwater monitoring now, landfill monitoring?
My understanding is that ATC Group Services is doing it now.
Okay, because I think I'd feel more comfortable and with the lower bid.
They've been the lower bidder now, I think, twice.
Okay. I have no problem.
So we have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Okay. All those in favor? Unanimous. Other new business, Mr. Waddell?
Nope.
Mr. Bridle?
Nope.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Yes, really quickly. The DES Waste Management Division on the Toll Plaza.
Yes.
Water, et cetera. Do we have to do anything with this?
It's only for our advice, for our knowledge. Certainly, if something goes wrong, I have a feeling that we'll be involved somewhere.
So for the moment?
We sent that to the operational departments, police, fire, building.
Okay.
Because there's always a potential for what they call a lust leak, underground leaking storage tank.
Right.
We want to make sure that they're aware of this because they may have to be engaged with the state in monitoring that.
Okay, because I don't want to be stuck
No, we're very sensitive to this, and I think the town of Northampton is too, because it also affects their community.
Mm, okay.
Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir.
Thank you for including that.
Now, our next meeting is going to be?
January 4th, sir.
Okay, so, moving on to closing comments, I would just like to thank all of the employees in the town. I think that we've had some good examples here tonight of people that have done a wonderful job. Christy, which, you know, the financial guru, and
poor thing.
We brought up Kevin Schultz, and he does a great job, and he's underappreciated. So I'd like to bring him, you know, bring his name up. But most of all, I'd like to bring up Jamie Sullivan. And I don't think the people out there realize the tremendous value that the town has gotten by having him in the position that he's in. And he has saved, from what I can see, the town a lot of money.
More than 30,000.
Yeah.
If you look at fuel, you look at negotiation costs, it's well over $100,000, and it's approaching $150,000, and he's replaced someone that was making a substantial salary to start with. So yeah. It's good numbers.
Yeah, so I'd like to thank all of the employees.
Ditto.
Yeah.
Ditto.
Roger.
And I hope everyone has a Merry Christmas.
Same to you.
Same to you. Same to all of you.
Any other closing comments?
No, I was just going to say Merry Christmas to the community.
And Happy New Year, because we won't be here before that.
That's
Happy
right.
Happy New Year, yeah. too.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen.
Motion to adjourn at 21:19.
Second.
All those in favor, unanimous.
Thank you.
The
we don't have any non-meeting.